Minister Levan, Izoria. We have permanent representatives of their nations to NATO. And of course, I fulfilled that role for a year for my country, but we're delighted to have the sitting permanent representatives with us today from the United Kingdom, from Italy, from Germany, and from the United States. That is a special role because it is a group of people sitting around the North Atlantic Council who collectively must agree in order for NATO to make any decisions. They are all people who are passionately committed to the transatlantic alliance and to what it stands for, the values and the interests and the shared security that we have. And yet it is a place where there are ferocious arguments and disagreements that take place because of that. But it's the strength of putting it all together that makes it work. And I also have a particular pleasure in introducing this panel because they are all very, very old friends, people I've known for many years, whether it is Adam Thomson, who worked in Washington in 1990, 1989, as I was a desk officer there and we teamed up together, Claudio Bisogniero, who was the Deputy Secretary General when I was ambassador. Prior to that, I had been in the European Bureau at the State Department, and he had been in the Foreign Ministry, and he's more recently served as ambassador to Washington. Honesty to Lucas, who had been the security policy and Russia specialist in the German Foreign Ministry before becoming political director, and then the ambassador at NATO, among other distinguished positions, and Doug Lute, who was a three-star general in the U.S. military, going to the White House to take responsibility for Iraq and Afghanistan policy, managing that extremely difficult task of serving two administrations, the Bush administration and the Obama administration, and finally becoming ambassador to NATO as well. It is a distinguished group of people. To manage this, to pull the questions out of our distinguished Minister of Defense and all these ambassadors, we have Robin Shepherd, who is a great friend and colleague in many of these kinds of think tank and post-government activities that I've had. I do have one further bit of advice to give, is that there are headsets over here on the table, and the minister is going to be speaking in Georgian. So for those of you who will need assistance in hearing that, please do pick up a headset. And with that, I will turn it over to Robin to get us started. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kurt, and thank you again. Everybody's said this, and this has been a wonderful couple of days here in Tbilisi. This is my third time in Georgia, and it never fails to inspire me as a country. I think it's a magical place, and I wanted to thank also the Georgians here for their tremendous hospitality. The subject of this discussion is the NATO summit in Warsaw, which happened in July, about 2 weeks after Brexit, the Brexit vote on June 23rd. I want to start with a thought. As Kurt said, I've moderated conferences like this for many years now. And for a long time, one of the questions that was either literally asked as the question for the panel, or was implicit in the discussion, was with a NATO. And that carried with it very often the thought that maybe NATO actually had nowhere to go, that it was a relic of the Cold War, as some people in some countries not very far from here would still suggest. And yet, my impression, especially of the Warsaw summit, is that it was the moment when, although NATO never went away, it is definitely back. This seemed to me to be the most resolute statement of values and strength and unity that I've seen for a long time from NATO, which is not to say NATO was weak before, it's just that it seems to me that a lot of things have come together. I actually did a little bit of counting up on my MacBook of the number of times Russia was mentioned in the joint communique. And it's slightly different if you say Russia or Russian, but it was 56 times. And for the Georgians present, you were mentioned 27 times. So, and Georgia was got obviously an enormous amount of attention at the conference. I wonder whether also the fact that the European Union, regardless of where one stands on the question of the European Union in so many different ways, it plainly is an institution which has serious problems. I don't think anybody is in denial about that anymore. There's great controversy as to how to solve those problems. And we've almost come, if you like, full circle back to the point in the early 90s when NATO was the transatlantic, the Western alliance par excellence. This is the one that survives. This is the one that really holds the line for everything else. I remember, as many will, in 2001, George W. Bush, President of the United States at the time, he went to Warsaw, And this followed the first round of expansion to the former communist countries of NATO in 1999, when the Czech Republic, Poland, and Hungary joined. And he said, what you build, you keep. And that statement of values of NATO is something that I think it was one of the most powerful statements to the Central and East European countries at the time. And I think, personally, is something that we now need to be extending to other building democracies, not least the one we're in today, that if they're going to build, they need to have a mechanism to keep. And I want to start with from the other end of the panel here with Ambassador Lute, in perhaps reflecting on that point. I mean, do you agree that actually this year marks something of a new milestone for NATO, that really NATO is back, and there is a renewed sense of purpose that perhaps hasn't quite been there in some years gone by?
Well, thanks very much, and thanks to the McCain Institute for the coolest setting for any panel discussion I've ever been on in my life. This is pretty good. You're setting a very high bar. That's right. I think this question of whether NATO has come up, this isn't the first time that maybe people have asked this question. And I think the last time the international community asked this question was probably about 25 years ago, so 1989, 1991, which saw probably the most substantial shift in security posture in Europe since the founding of NATO. And of course, that was the fall of the Berlin Wall, the fall of the Iron Curtain, the dissolution of the Soviet Union, and historic events that are very close here when you're in Tbilisi. And you know, just after that inflection point, people also ask, so what's up with NATO? I mean, is there still a reason for NATO and so forth? And after that 89 to 91 period, NATO found its feet. And it recognized that while the Soviet Union no longer existed, there were threats of instability, threats of insecurity from just outside our Article 5 boundaries that would have a dramatic impact on NATO itself. I think we're at another point like that. And I say that because now that a more assertive, more aggressive Russia is back on the scene in a very obvious way, it's been obvious here in Tbilisi for some time, but now it's obvious, I think, to everyone that we have a challenge, a security challenge to the east. We also have these sources of instability outside of NATO territory, mass migration, refugee flows, terrorists. I mean, you have European cities being bombed today by a terrorist threat that emanates from outside NATO and migrates or infiltrates in. So I think it's the combination of those threats, both east and south, that today combine to put us at another historic inflection point for NATO. Maybe only the second one of its kind in the 67-year history of the alliance.
And just to follow up, at that inflection point, is this also a moment to go beyond the rhetoric which is there about bringing in Georgia and Ukraine into NATO, and actually use this as a springboard for reinvigorating the political classes, most particularly in the West, and in your case, the United States of America, Ambassador Lute, that, you know, that it used to be the question with NATO, now it's with enlargement. I mean, is this a moment where we actually can really get cracking with enlargement?
Well, NATO has never taken a time out on enlargement. In fact, we just met with the Georgian Prime Minister, and within that sort of two-hour conversation, it was remarked that enlargement isn't just a policy of NATO, it's actually an obligation of the alliance. So it goes all the way back to the Washington Treaty itself, and Article 10 of the treaty says that NATO will be open to inviting additional members, and seven times in our history, we've done it. I mean, what's really telling to me is that sitting right next to us, next to me personally, at the NATO Georgia Commission just a few minutes ago, was my Montenegrin ambassador counterpart. And of course, Montenegro is in the midst of the accession process. So if you need any better demonstration that the door remains open and that it's not just a policy, but it's an obligation, you should talk to the Montenegrin ambassador. She's right here.
Thank you. And Ambassador Lucas, essentially the same question, but also feel free to back into this point. I mean, do you agree that this is a kind of inflection point? This is a point where we have actually completely reinvigorated the sense of NATO's purpose, which for people working in NATO perhaps was never missing, but for people who are looking at NATO from the outside, certainly seems to be, after the Warsaw Summit, much more obvious. And with that general thought in mind, also perhaps address the question of Germany's position right now on enlargement. In theory, of course, Germany's in favor of enlargement, but is Germany really prepared to grab this nettle and move forward fast on enlargement so that we address the question that the Georgians and the Russians are having to address every day? And I'm also minded that one of the issues that everybody's concerned about is the partial occupation of Georgia and Ukraine. And yet I'm reminded that that Germany joined NATO as a divided country as well.
Thank you very much. I mean, on this renewed sense of purpose, I still recall when in my previous job as German political director, when we started in 2013 to prepare the Wales summit, and had conversations with my colleagues and collaborators, and the question was, what were you going to do in Wales? I mean, the key question to be discussed at Wales, is there anything to do for NATO after Afghanistan? And that changed quickly with the Russian annexation of the Crimea and Russia's policy in the eastern Ukraine. So there is certainly a new sense of purpose there, but not only because of challenges in the east, but also challenges in the south. And I think what NATO has to cope with right now is a historically new situation. It's really this double challenge, double strategic challenge, both in the east and the south. That never happened before. So in that respect, I think we managed at Warsaw, I mean, to give quite convincing answer to this double challenge. And we showed that this alliance is united. And by the way, it's an organization nobody wants to leave. I think that's important to stress this nowadays. Secondly, I think we also showed that we deliver, so that we implemented everything which we decided at Wales, in particular the readiness action plan. So it's just not about talking, it's also about walking. And thirdly, I think we showed that this alliance is able to adapt, I mean, to these new challenges I just mentioned. And in that respect, I think that decisions which have been taken at Warsaw regarding enhanced forward presence to the east, or, I mean, projecting stability towards the south, essentially, I mean, really underline, you know, that this alliance is alive and kicking and able to adapt. Having said this, I think that Warsaw is, as Doug has said, is an inflection point, but it's not an end point. So I think we are in a process of permanent adaptation, given that our security environment is rapidly changing. So all in all, I mean, I have a sort of also a very positive outlook as far as NATO is concerned. On the enlargement, I can only support what has been said by Doug. I think that we are now about, I mean, to have Montenegro as a new member of the alliance shows that the open doors policy is a substantial policy. It's just not words, it's filled with substance. And I think if you look at the future, this process may continue. And but of course we have, I mean, to look at each and every sort of case on its own merits. I think as far as Georgia is concerned, I mean, we have made great progress. We decided at Warsaw a number of additional measures in the context of the substantial package, and I think that's a very good instrument in order to move Georgia closer and closer to the alliance.
Just picking up very quickly on the point about Montenegro, which is very welcome that Montenegro is in the alliance, there is of course a school of thought that Montenegro is in a sense the easy way of enlarging. I mean, it isn't got anything like the security threats as that Georgia has and Ukraine has, and in a sense it sort of plays as almost a good cop, bad cop, and this is easy to get get Montenegro in, and by doing so it sort of alleviates a bit of the pressure when anybody asks a question about further commitments to enlargement. I mean, there's no doubt about it, enlarging into Georgia and Ukraine is tough, But tough isn't the same as impossible. And do you actually believe that there is a real world scenario in which Georgia joins NATO within the coming years?
Well, I think we have taken decisions at Bucharest, where we said that Georgia will eventually become a member of NATO, and I think we have sort of reconfirmed this decision at the Warsaw Summit, and I think we are now in the midst of process of moving Georgia closer and closer to the alliance, and I think that the substantial package is an excellent means in order, I mean, to move towards this goal.
Thank you. Mr. Bisogniero, I hope I got the pronunciation more or less correct. Italy has, Italy is of course one of the biggest contributors to NATO, it's one of the most politically influential, it is a major country with new security concerns following the migration crisis, which is something that the NATO summit addressed. In a sense, NATO's commitment to Italy's commitment to NATO it becomes easier and stronger because of a specific issue. But is Italy also committed to enlargement in any real sense? It is always one thing to write something down in a communique on a piece of paper. But do the Italian political classes, does Mr. Renzi, does he think that NATO is going to be expanded into the former Soviet space?
Well, thank you very much. And let me say, before I respond to your question, I would like to really salute Kurt Volker, who was an outstanding ambassador to NATO. A small secret I may reveal here, if you hear me fine. He flew in on an early day, in early morning in August, 2008, I should say. And we had a knack that day, and he had to drive straight to NATO, step into my office, shake hands, introduce himself as the new U.S. ambassador in order to be able to attend that crucial NAC meeting in August of 2008. So thank you for your question. I would answer the whole set of questions put so far. Is NATO back? Yes, it is, very clearly so, but frankly, NATO never went away, and the decisions taken in Warsaw are a clear indication of that. I think at the end of the day, it's all about the indivisibility of allied security. We are 28 allies, soon to become 29, and we tackle the different set of challenges together, in the support of everybody else. So the set of decisions in Warsaw indeed tackle the defense and deterrence, so the threat emanating from the East, with very important decisions. And let me tell you immediately, Italy is a country from the South, so a completely different geographical setup, but we are a major and active contributor to those decisions taken to defend the Eastern members of the alliance. And the same applies to the projecting stability process, which tackles the challenges emanating from the South. I'm sure that all allies are committed to that as well. Enlargement that you asked me about is a process, as my German and American colleagues have outlined. Article 10 of the treaty is very, very clear. The decision taken in Bucharest and reiterated many, many times, including in Warsaw, are very, very clear. By the way, I happened to be sitting at the table of the Bucharest summit in 2008, so I have a very clear sense of the weight of the commitments taken on that occasion. It is a process in which NATO works towards that direction, in which a country like Georgia works towards that direction with reforms and adaptation. NATO takes decisions like the substantial package, and the NATO allies actively contribute to that. Italy is an active contributor to the reforms here, including in the defense and security sector. So it is a process to which we are all clearly committed.
And just one quick follow-up, similar to the question I asked Ambassador Lucas and also Ambassador Lute. Do you really believe that, let me even be a little more specific, do you believe that Georgia can be a member, realistically, within the next 5 years?
This is the process I just described, towards which all the countries of NATO and Georgia are working to. Montenegro is now an invited member, soon to become a full member, not because you suggested it is the easy country to get in. It is getting in because of its own merits, because of what Montenegro has done in terms of reforms and adaptation. And this is the kind of process that tackles all the countries who are in the pipeline, who are in the process of joining the alliance. There are several, as you know, and Georgia is one of them.
I mean, I appreciate you can't put a time limit on this, but essentially what you and your colleagues are nailing is that anyone who's sitting around in a capital city somewhere a little bit north of here, thinking that it was an easy option to get Montenegro in and we'll never get really get Georgia and Ukraine in, they're mistaken in that belief, that it's the easy option, and that therefore we can
I think I just answered your question.
Yeah.
Montenegro is not getting in because it is the easy option. It is getting in its own merit, and that would be the kind of judgment regarding all the countries who are aspiring countries to become members of NATO.
Thank you. I'm going to jump over to Ambassador Thomson, and then I'll ask Minister Izoria to make some sort of remarks of his own, but also some responses, if I may. Could you just pass the microphone over? Ambassador Thomson, feel free, obviously, to respond to any of the issues raised. I think it is important to get this point clear. Does everybody agree that NATO really has reached, as Ambassador Lute said, a kind of inflection point, that NATO has really reinvigorated its sense of purpose, and that the Warsaw Summit, certainly part of a process of previous summits moving up to it, but did mark a kind of a sort of landmark, or perhaps if that's too strong a term, certainly a place where NATO has, it never went away, but it has really come back into the fore of our thinking. And also, since you are in fact the British Permanent Representative, and I would be not forgiven for asking at least something about Brexit, do you get a sense, and I'm going to put you my personal opinion and then see whether you agree with it, so I'm not putting any words at all into your mouth, that now that Britain is going to leave the European Union, Britain has always been very strongly engaged in NATO, but it will be even more committed to showing the world that it has not stepped back from its international obligations, and that if it is possible, that Britain will be an even stronger member of NATO than before.
Well, thank you very much, Robin. And can I just say thank you very much, Kurt. It's been at least 20 years of happy collaboration, and for my part, education by Kurt of me, of the mysteries of the US interagency process, and much more on the Paul Mill world. So it's a pleasure to be here, Kurt. Thank you very much. Your first question, is this an inflection point? Yes, we are in a number of years, we don't know how many, that are as significant for Europe's security and therefore for NATO as 1989 to 1991 was. And that's really bad news, because it's not a hopeful outlook in the 20-teens as it was 1989 to 91. It isn't so much NATO reinvigorating itself, because as Claudio said, NATO never went away. It is Russia and ISIL invigorating NATO, forcing us to move from creative partnership back to some of the difficult questions of collective defense that we thought we had reached a point of not needing to pay so much attention to. So I think an important point to make about where we are right now, in a moment of fluidity for the alliance and for Europe's well-being, is that the choices we make in this period are every bit as significant as those that NATO's leaders made in 1989 to 91 period. They need to be, in some respects, the same choices, the same values, but different choices. We have no interest in finding ourselves heading back to a new Cold War. We need to find more creative ways of delivering on security in Europe. So a point on Georgia in all of this. I think that while NATO engages with Georgia and contributes a great deal to this country's Euro-Atlantic perspective, so the alliance has plenty to learn from Georgia about how to live in a difficult neighborhood, how to combine defense toughness and a sense of what you stand for with a willingness to find peaceful ways forward through dialogue. And you asked me about Brexit. I'm not sure that Brexit changes the UK's position in NATO or towards NATO so very much. We were before the referendum, and we remain since Europe's largest military power, second most significant military capability in the alliance after the United States. We have every interest since the referendum, just as before it, in contributing our full share to stabilizing Europe and meeting these multiple threats. So as far as I'm concerned, in NATO, it is steady as we go, playing the fullest part we can in moving the alliance forward in unity as fast as we can to relearn the skills of collective defense, even while we continue to pursue the skills we've learned since 1991 in partnership. And I just close by noting, and I think this answers your follow-up question about Georgia and whether it can ever become an alliance member. Yet again, as in almost every NATO summit declaration, leaders said at Warsaw that they believed in a Europe whole, free, and at peace.
But here's the question, is Georgia part of Europe? Because this is, I mean, I could answer that question in the affirmative. We've had some discussions about the way people perceive Georgia. Does Mrs. May think Georgia, Prime Minister May, think Georgia is part of Europe?
Yes, she does. Just as the alliance is more than a narrow definition of Europe, we couldn't function without Canada and the United States. So we have always envisaged Europe as a greater Europe. We have, for example, as a long-standing NATO member, Turkey, half in and half out on some definitions. I don't think any NATO ally has any difficulty contemplating Georgia as part of that greater Europe definition.
Thank you very much. At this point, I'm going to ask people to put on their headphones because Minister Izoria is going to speak in Georgian. So I'm going to do the same thing. We'll have a tiny experiment to see whether we can actually make this work. I think, am I right in saying that zero will give English speakers English? Oh, it was in Georgian. Are we in the right place on zero? Is that correct? We think so. Well, if not, we'll move. Okay, well, thank you. It's a great honor. No, that actually is in Georgian. Ah, okay. All right. This should work. It's a great pleasure and a great honor to have Minister Izoria here. As I understand it, congratulations are in order because this is a relatively new job. You were appointed in August, is that correct? Thank you again for being here, and you have the opportunity to tell your panelists whether you're convinced, whether you believe that that NATO is going to make good on its statements. All the gentlemen present have been very clear that enlargement is not a theoretical concept, it's something that happens. We've seen that with Montenegro. Feel free to respond however you'd like to the comments made by the ambassadors, but on a very specific point, do you yourself believe that Georgia is going to be a member of NATO in the next few years? Let's say in 5 years' time as a benchmark.
Მოგესალმებით, ფიქრობ რომ არამხოლოდ მე მაქვს ამის რწმენა, არამედ უმრავლესობას საქართველოს მოსახლეობის და მე ვფიქრობ რომ ეს ჩვენი საერთო რწმენაა პარტნიორებთან ერთად, ნატოსთან ერთად. ჩვენი სტრატეგიული არჩევანია რომ ვიყოთ სწორედ ნატოს წევრი ქვეყანა და ეს არჩევანი უკავშირდება იმას რომ ჩვენ გვინდა ვიყოთ წესებზე დაფუძნებული უსაფრთხოების სისტემის ნაწილი. იმიტომ რომ ეს არის თითოეული ადამიანის საქართველოში ღირსეული არსებობის საფუძველი. თანამედროვე დასავლურმა ცივილიზაციამ სწორედ დემოკრატიული და სამართლებრივი სახელმწიფოს შექმნით უზრუნველყო როგორც თითოეული ერების, ვინც ამ წესებზე დაფუძნებული უსაფრთხოების სისტემის ნაწილია, ისე ამ ქვეყნების მოქალაქეების ღირსეული არსებობა. ამიტომ ნატოში ინტეგრაცია ეს არის ჩვენი ეროვნული თვითრეალიზაციის პროცესი. ეს არის პროცესი, რომელიც დაკავშირებულია სწორედ ამ უსაფრთხოების წესებზე დაფუძნებული უსაფრთხოების სისტემაში გაწევრიანებასთან პირველ რიგში. რაც შეეხება რწმენას იმასთან დაკავშირებით, უნდა გაგრძელდეს თუ არა გაფართოების პოლიტიკა, ცალსახა პასუხია რომ კი, და ამას მოწმობს სხვათა შორის სულ რაღაც ორი თვის წინ ევროპის გლობალური უსაფრთხოების სტრატეგია, რომელშიც ცალსახად არის გაწერილი მნიშვნელობა იმისა, თუ რატომ უნდა გაგრძელდეს პოლიტიკა გაფართოების, იმიტომ რომ ევროპის უსაფრთხოება იმ გამოწვევებმა, რის წინაშეც ევროპა დღეს დგას, საფრთხეები რუსეთიდან, ტერორისტული საფრთხეები, ჰიბრიდული და სხვა კიბერშეტევები, მოწმობს ერთს, რომ თუ მეზობელია უსაფრთხოდ, თუ მეზობელ ქვეყანაში არის დემოკრატიული განვითარება, მაშინ ეს უსაფრთხოება არის ევროპაში უზრუნველყოფილი. ამიტომ მთავარი მესიჯი და მთავარი გზავნილი ამ სტრატეგიული დოკუმენტის არის სწორედ ამ პოლიტიკის, გაფართოების პოლიტიკის გაგრძელება. გაფართოება არის უსაფრთხოების ინტერესებიდან მნიშვნელოვანი მსოფლიოში და თითოეული ქვეყნის, ვინც ამ წესებზე დაფუძნებული უსაფრთხოების სისტემის ნაწილია. ასევე ამ გაფართოების პოლიტიკას ხას უსვამს სწორედ ვარშავის სამიტზე მიღებული საფრთხეების შეკავების სტრატეგია და ჩვენ გვინდა ვიყოთ სწორედ ინტეგრირებული ამ სტრატეგიის. და როგორ ხედავ მე, როგორც თავდაცვის მინისტრი, ამ სტრატეგიის განხორციელების კონკრეტულ და პრაქტიკულ გეგმას. ჩვენი მთავარი მიზანია, რომ შევძლოთ ჩვენ თვითონ, როგორც ღირსეულმა პარტნიორმა, თქვენი მხარდაჭერით საკუთარი თავი დავიცვათ თვითონ, ქონდეს ამის უნარი, ქონდეს უნარი რომ საფრთხეები თვითონ შევაკავოთ და ქონდეს უნარი რომ ეს იყოს მდგრადი პროცესი. ეს არის ერთ-ერთი ძალიან მნიშვნელოვანი ამოცანა. თავდაცვის მინისტრი ამ ამოცანის განხორციელების კონკრეტულ გეგმას უკვე ხედავს. მინდა ეს თქვენს წინაშე დავაანონსო და ასევე ბატონ სტოლტენბერგს ეს ინფორმაცია მივაწედო, რომ მთელი ამ ერთი თვის განმავლობაში ჩვენ სწორედ თქვენთან ერთად, ანუ ნატოს წევრ და სხვა პარტნიორ ქვეყნებთან ერთად, ინტენსიურად მუშაობდით ახალ სტრატეგიაზე და უკვე ჩვენ ეს სტრატეგია მზად გვაქვს თავისი 4-წლიანი სამოქმედო გეგმით. და ამ სტრატეგიის მთავარი მიზანია, ის 5 კომპონენტისგან შედგება, რომ ძალების მზადყოფნა თავდაცვის ინსტიტუციონალური სიმყარე და სიმტკიცე იყოს პრიორიტეტული. ამ თვალსაზრისით ძალიან მნიშვნელოვანია ასევე
ჩვენი სტრატეგიული პარტნიორის ამერიკის შეერთებული შტატების ხარდაჭერა და მემორანდუმის მთავარი ამოცანა და მიზანი, რომელიც ჩვენ ორი თვენახევრის წინ გავაფორმეთ, სწორედ იმაში მდგომარეობს, რომ საქართველოს შეიარაღებულ ძალებს ჰქონდეთ უნარი თავდაცვის და პროგრამა, რომელიც საქართველოს მზადყოფნის პროგრამას უკავშირდება, მიზნად ისახავს. პირველი, შესაბამისი პერსონალის, შესაბამისი აღჭურვილობის შეძენას და პერსონალის ყოლას და რაც მთავარია და ფოკუსი ამ მთავარი ორივე როგორც ნატოს არსებითი პაკეტის ისე მემორანდუმის ფარგლებში წვრთნების ელემენტი. ჩვენ აუცილებლად იმ უნარებს, რასაც ქვია შეკავება საფრთხეების, თავდაცვის უნარიანობის გაზრდა, შევძლებთ მხოლოდ და მხოლოდ ერთობლივი წვრთნებისა და ამ წვრთნების შეფასების საფუძველზე, რათა ვიყოთ სწორედ იმ სიმაღლეზე მოწოდების, რა მოლოდინიც აქვს ჩვენს პარტნიორებს და ნატოს წევრებს ჩვენი ქვეყნის მიმართ. ამიტომ, ბუნებრივია, ცალკეულ მინისტრს და ყველას ალბათ, ვინც მუშაობას იწყებს, არამხოლოდ უნდა ჰქონდეს წმენაც, რას აკეთებს, და ასე უნდა ჰქონდეს კონკრეტული გეგმა, რას აკეთებს. ეს ორივე სინქრონიზებულია სწორედ იმ სამოქმედო გეგმაში, რომელიც ჩვენ უკვე ჩვენს კოლეგებსაც და პარტნიორებს გაუგზავნეთ და რისი ამბიციაც გვაქვს, რომ ახლო მომავალში განახორციელოთ. ანუ მოკლედ რო გიპასუხოთ, რასაკვირველია, ჩვენს თანამშრომლობას მხოლოდ მაშინ აქვს პერსპექტივა, როდესაც ჩვენ გაფართოების პოლიტიკის რწმენა გვაქვს. ჩვენს თანამშრომლობას მაშინ აქვს პერსპექტივა, როდესაც თითოული თავის კონკრეტულ ამოცანას ხედავს და საქართველოს და მის თავდაცვის მინის ამთავრობის პირობებში დანახული აქვს ამოცანა კონკრეტული იმ თვალსაზრისით, რომ გააძლიეროს თავისი შესაძლებლობები. ეს შეიძლება გარკვეულ სერიოზულ რეფორმებთან იყოს დაკავშირებული, მე ვთქვი, მაგალითად, აღჭურვილობაზე. სამწუხარო რეალობაა დღეს საქართველოში, რომ ძალიან ბევრი მოძველებული ტექნიკაა. შეიძლება ითქვას, რომ თანხები და მილიონები თანხები იხარჯება სამწუხაროდ, მათ შეკეთებაზეც კი. ანუ ეს ერთი კონკრეტული მაგალითია, რომ ცვლილებები შეიძლება პრიორიტეტულ მიმართულებებს შეეხოს და სტრატეგიულ მართვას უკავშირდება. ცვლილებები შეიძლება შეეხოს სტრუქტურულ ოპტიმიზაციას და რასაკვირველია, მთავარი და ამოსავლი არის ძალების მზადყოფნა. და მზადყოფნაში ვგულისხმობ თქვენთან მჭიდრო თანამშრომლობით ამ შესაძლებლობების, როგორც თავდაცვის შესაძლებლობების, ისე ინსტიტუციონალური შესაძლებლობების გაძლიერებას, რათა ჩვენ თვითონ ვიყოთ ყარი, ჩვენ თვითონ ვიყოთ ძლიერნი, იმიტომ რომ ჩვენ ერთმანეთს სწორედ ძლიერები ვჭირდებით და ჩვენ უნდა ვიყოთ მდგრადი და მყარი სახელმწიფო დემოკრატიული და სამართლებრივი ღირებულებებით. ამიტომ თუ აი ამ სტრატეგიებს, რომელიც მე თავში ვახსენე, მოკლედ შევაფასებდი, ამოცანა თითოეული როგორც ევროპული ქვეყნის, ისე ჩვენი სტრატეგიული პარტნიორის ამერიკის შეერთებული შტატების არის სახელმწიფოების ადგილზე გაძლიერება. და მე მინდა აქვე დავამატო იგივე ამოცანის წინაშე დგას ჩვენი საერთო მხარდაჭერით ავღანეთი, სადაც პირველი საერთაშორისო ვიზიტი სულ რაღაც 10 დღის წინ განახორციელე და იქ ჩვენ მსჯელობაში მივედით იმ დასკვნამდე, ეს ისეთი აპრობირებული აზრია, რომ არა ერთწლიანი ყოფნა, არამედ გრძელვადიანი პერსპექტივებია აუცილებელი, სამწლიანი, ოთხწლიანი, იმისთვის, რომ გლობალური უსაფრთხოება და მშვიდობა იყოს მსოფლიოში უზრუნველყოფილი. ამიტომ მსოფლიოს უსაფრთხოება ითხოვს ჩვენგან მოკლედ რო გაქცეთ პასუხი იმ პოლიტიკის გაგრძელებას, რასაც ქვია გაფართოების პოლიტიკა.
Thank you very much indeed. And also as a point to, I mean, I suppose everybody here knows this anyway, but joining NATO is a cross-party matter in Georgia, and there's a declaration signed at the or released at the summit in Warsaw. So it goes across the political spectrum. We've only got, I wish it would go on for another hour, but we've only got about another 10 minutes. Ambassador Lute and Ambassador Bisogniero wanted to make a comment in response to, or perhaps in response or in addition to the minister's comments. And then I want to go for at least a couple of questions to the audience.
So just very briefly, I want to share with you, the audience, what it's like for us to get in an airplane and fly to Tbilisi. You know, in Brussels, it's one thing to talk about enlargement, it's one thing to talk about Russia's irresponsible behavior and so forth, but as we sit here in this courtyard, not too many tens of kilometers from here, there are Russian troops occupying sovereign Georgian territory. It feels different here than it feels in Brussels. Not far beyond Abkhazia and South Ossetia, there are Russian troops, again, circumventing, skirting the spirit and the word of the Vienna document by way of the Kavkaz exercise. I mean, most cynically, their version of inviting observers to this exercise is to invite observers to Crimea. I mean, really? So when you think about tough neighborhood, you realize what the people of Georgia are living with every single day in this neighborhood. And so it's really special for us to be here today. And it adds, I think, special meaning to the sorts of decisions that were taken at Wales and then Warsaw and the kind of work we try to advance every day. So I really want to thank our Georgian hosts for what you put up with in this neighborhood, for your responsible behavior in the face of irresponsible behavior, and very just sort of, I think, tactically for this visit. So thanks.
Thank you, Ambassador Bisogniero.
Thank you. Very briefly, just wanted to pick up on a couple of points that Minister Izoria has made. One is on reforms, and the second one is on values. On reforms, I think the set of reforms that the government has undertaken is truly impressive, and we support that process, and we stand ready to do even more, including in the defense-to-defense collaboration. We have an ongoing bilateral agreement in defense collaboration between Italy and Georgia, and we want to do more to contribute to the process in this country. The second point, extremely important, has to do with values, but also the European Union. You have mentioned repeatedly the European Union. At the end of the day, our organizations are based upon shared principles, shared values that are extremely important. We are talking about democracy, freedom, liberty, rule of law. And these are commitments that Georgia takes very, very seriously. And for instance, your relations with the European Union, the entry into force, I think on the 1st of July, of the association agreement with the European Union is extremely important, because when we talk about Euro-Atlantic integration, this is exactly what we are referring to. So I just wanted to say that I see that we have to stop, but we stand by for those important values, and we know that Georgia is committed to them very, very soon.
Well, thank you very much. The Secretary General of NATO is here, and we are going to have to bring this this gathering between us, not between everybody else, to a close. Thank you. This has been extremely informative. We really appreciate Minister Izoria for taking the time, ambassadors for coming here to address this forum, and we shall see. I personally believe Georgia will be in NATO in 5 years, but that's why I'm a moderator, not a panelist, so don't trust me. Thank you very much, and please show our appreciation.